Greetings, 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 greetings. Welcome to another edition of 15 Minutes of Flame. I'm Robert Phoenix, and we're on an express train today. You're going to get your 15 minutes and a little bit more. Not as much as usual, because I have to, I got a big day as an astrologer, and it starts in about 18 minutes. So let's get going. Oh, the high strange begins. The high strange begins with Texas and Sutherland Springs. Where do we start? Well, how about the fact that they got the dates of the event a little bit wrong? It came to my attention yesterday through a couple of people on Facebook. And again, if you follow me on Facebook, you're privy to a lot of this stuff. And I know people that I don't do social media. Facebook sucks. It is, you know, until I get shut down or until the content gets removed, it's still one of the best places for me to exchange information. I don't go over to 4chan. I mean, I do, but I go there to read. I don't go to post or anything like that, or Reddit. So a lot of the stuff that I talk about is on my Facebook page. So I urge you, if you're not, you can even just create a profile. You don't even have to, you know, enter anything in. But if you want to follow some of this stuff, I can't necessarily put it on my website because my website's about astrology. It's not necessarily about the things that I talk about all the time, although there's an overlap in many cases. Anyway, one of the anomalies, or some of the anomalies now, are the fact that there is a timestamp of a reporter for ABC News actually talking about the shooting, and it's from November 4th, which is a day before it actually happened. And there's another series and sequence of dates that are from a Google search, which are from the day before actually talking about the shooting. Where have we seen this before? We saw it with Sandy Hook. So there are anomalies and discrepancies here. Of course, it is not going to be a slam dunk anymore when we try to get in and untangle the stuff. And then through a strange series of coincidences, I have two Facebook friends who don't know each other, who both know a family that lost 10 people in the shooting, which is very odd. It's very, very odd. And apparently one of the people lives here in Texas. I would actually like to meet that person and talk with them. Again, if you look at the crime scene, one of the things that you don't see is you don't see any blood. This is one of the things that is always kind of mind-boggling. Again, we have to be really careful. We have to be super careful because we don't want to put our foot in our mouth by saying, oh, another false flag. Oh, you know, but we have to entertain these possibilities and we have to untangle the fact that there could be a hybrid event, it could be, you know, a false flag that is wrapped up in a PSYOP, which is the trauma burrito. That's what it is. It's the trauma burrito. There's layers. So we have to be, you know, gotta be delicate and somewhat sensitive, but at the same time, right, we can't just immediately co-sign and say, well, this happened the way it happened. You look at the people, again, look at the people who are now giving testimony. There is not a shred of emotion in these people. You know, I saw that pastor and, you know, he's wiping his eyes. Like, there's nothing coming out of your eyes, buddy. There's nothing coming out of your eyes. And your wife who read the statement, you know, I get it. People are like, oh, well, people show grief in different ways. Yeah, they show grief. Is everybody who's at these events now, are they just machines? Is that what they are? Is this how robotoids show grief? Maybe this is what we're dealing with. Maybe we're not dealing with crisis actors anymore. We're dealing with crisis automatons. Seriously. And we have to take this into consideration. You may think I'm completely nuts, but it's true. Because consistently over all these events, how can these people not show any grief? I remember going back to the Dylann Roof shooting. Again, a theoretical shooting. I love how Alex Jones just sells it. He has to now because he got you know, tripped up with Sandy Hook. So now Alex Jones has to take the party line. He has to. And he could take another angle which says, well, this guy is Antifa scum, and you know, he can use this to adrenalize his listeners. By the way, I was watching AJ talk to Scott Adams, the guy who created Dilbert, and he's really bright. Scott Adams is really, really bright. He's a smart guy. He understands psychology. He understands hypnosis and trance and cognitive dissonance. The guy's sharp. He's a Gemini, of course. And Alex, in typical blustery Alex Jones fashion, just stomps all over him in the interview, and basically says, well, Trump got elected because of me and our listeners and my supporters. We're the ones. We're the secret sauce. And Scott Adams doesn't say, yeah, yeah, yeah. He says, well, you may be right. I don't know. You certainly have a large reach. And he didn't co-sign on Alex's chest beating that he and the InfoWar community were the cogs that got Trump elected. I don't know about that. Was there a push? Yeah, sure, absolutely. Anyway, Alex talked about Columbia, South Carolina, where there was a big shooting a couple of years ago with Dylann Roof, and he called him a racist, and because he had a flag, a Confederate flag, it kickstarted everything. Again, if you look at the people that were the survivors of that shooting, there's no emotion, and not only that, oh, we forgive him. We forgive him. It's just love. God is love. Love, 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 love. It's 2 days after this thing's happened. There's not a tear in their eyes. It's, oh, just we forgive him. I wonder when that's going to come out around Sutherland Springs. The people are zombies. You look at them, they're smiling. The people, it's like, yeah, that's weird. It's like the village of the damned. Who are these people? So we've got all these strange occurrences. Like, okay, the pastor wasn't there. Pastor's wife wasn't there. Kind of like 9/11 when a bunch of businesses, well, a few specifically, didn't show up at 9/11. How convenient. What a strange synchronicity. Oh, what an act of God. God saved us. God spared us. No, God took our daughter, who looked like she had some form of physical, perhaps a mental challenge. You look at the picture, it's like, whoa, hey, this girl's challenged. You can see it, right? Well, God took her because, you know, God takes the innocent. But God spared them through the great loving grace of God. He's going to put them through a very difficult time, theoretically, losing that very special child. And again, hey, look, it might have happened. All right, I got to cover my bases on this, got to cover my ass. But at the same time, there's no emotion. You know, I mean, can't they get better actors? I'm sorry. Can't they get better actors? You know, I want to see that preacher, like, just lose it, right? I want to see him lose it like that Rodriguez guy from Santa Barbara. Remember him? And all his fake tears. Where's he?
Oh, I'm going to dedicate my life to removing these terrible weapons of what they did to my son.
Where's that guy? He came on strong. He had his little, you know, what was it? 2 weeks, basically. They got about 2 weeks worth of crocodile tears and bearing false witness from that guy. Why couldn't the pastor from Sutherland Springs go into the same kind of histrionic? You know, he's a pastor. The guy is known for his oratory skills, and he's handing it off. He's handing the ball to his wife, who's got about as much charisma as an accountant for the IRS. Okay, maybe, I don't want to piss off the IRS, but I would think that there's a psychological type that is part of the program that doesn't require a whole lot of charisma. Okay? She's got none. This is a perfect opportunity for Mr. Pastor
to get into, you know, scripture from the Bible and talk about, you know, how this affects our lives. No, he just sits there. He just sits there with his glasses, sunglasses on, because he's not crying. He's not crying. But he puts his hand to his cheek just to make sure that he has the, you know, this,
I'm a man, I don't emote, I'm holding my emotions back. I've got a handlebar Fu Manchu. And I ride a motorcycle and I bring it in the church.
Have you seen the pictures of the church in the inside? Not very church-like. Not to say that the church has got to look like a church. You step outside and you're in the church, right? You're in the church right now. You're in the church right now. Here we go. Hey! You are. There is no separation. The only thing that separates you is the congregation. And the congregation of coming together with people in real time, real space. But even now, you're in a congregation. Right? You're in a virtual congregation. Anyway, that was the moment in time for that guy. My God. His God. Our God. Whatever. What does he do? You know what that's like? I'll tell you what that's like. It's like it's fourth and goal from the half-yard line, okay? And I'm going to try to give you, and you've got the biggest, baddest running back of all time. All time. Let's just throw him in there. How about Earl Campbell? He's from Texas. There were basically three seasons where Earl Campbell was virtually unstoppable, okay? Unstoppable. His thighs are as big as my torso, okay? That's how unstoppable he is. And you're on the 1 yard line. Don't you hand the ball off to, you know, Earl Campbell, or better yet, I'll use another analogy. Let's say you put Earl Campbell in a quarterback. And Earl, you're just gonna take the ball with all your massive, you know, humanity, right? All your muscle, all your strength. And you're just going to punch that thing right across the goal line. But just in case, we're going to try to fake people out. We're going to put a guy behind you who weighs 190 pounds. And there are 11 people on the line of scrimmage. And Earl at the last minute says, you know, I gave it some thought. And I'm going to hand it off to the 198-pound guy. And the 198-pound guy gets the ball and just slams into the line. Game over. You see, that's Earl Campbell's moment in time. To take the ball, put it across the goal line. That guy, that was his moment. He was kind of Earl Campbell playing quarterback in that moment. What does he do? He hands it off to the wife, who gives this testimony that is like, it's bizarre. The whole thing reeks of more bizarreness. You know, it's another attention grab, trying to be a gun grab in Texas. Come on, people. Like, there's just two people, these random people, who know the same person who lost 10 people. And this one person lives in Texas. And I want to talk to that person. I want to meet with that person. I'd like to know, and I know this sounds cold. I apologize. I'd like to know where the burial arrangements are. Is there going to be a funeral for 10 people? I mean, think about this. This is not just your average funeral. And I apologize if I sound cold here. I'm not trying to, okay? But I have to be somewhat, how do I say this? I've got to be somewhat rational around this. Burying 10 people is not your average kind of event, okay? It's not your average event. Burying 10 people is a major deal. You've got to get 10 caskets. There's plots, everything. Now, are they going to be incinerated? Is that what's going to happen? Are they going to be put in little cedar boxes? I don't know. But I'd like to know. Does that sound cold? I don't think so. I think we have a right to know. Because the history of this country and the future of this country and the future of the world depends to some extent on these events. But guess what? By the time we get to the point where we're pulling everything apart, we're pulling the guts out of the engine, there's going to be another event. I guarantee it. It's going to happen. So now we're running over here, right? We're no longer talking about Vegas. We're no longer dealing with Santa Rosa. Now we're dealing with the thing in Texas. Oh boy. Hopefully, to catch them in a pit of their lies so that we can put an end to this egregious bullshit that we're being led through by the false flag or the mass shooting of the week. So what's next? Is it going to be the Muslim theme now? It's the alternating theme, right? White guy Muslim, white guy Muslim, white guy Muslim, white guy Muslim, white guy Muslim. There should be a song. Somebody should do a song about it. Oh boy. Anyway, I'm about to get out of here because I've got official duties today as an astrologer. Yes, I do that. And I want to thank everybody for signing up for the Everything package and program. That was great. Such great response. And I love the readings. They're fantastic. It's one of my favorite things to do. It's like super in-depth. I think provident. I think it helps. I think people get a lot out of it because of the amount of time and, the connections that are made through these various systems for the individual. So thank you, everybody who signed up for that. I'm still waiting for Regina to get her the editing together for their interview. Some of you have been asking about my interview with Regina, and that it should be up maybe next week or the week after. She's in the midst of redoing her website, and so it's going to be kind of a big deal. It's a big multimedia deal, and this is Regina. There's no secret here. This is Regina moving out more in a solo space, I wish her just a ton of luck and fortuitousness, because theoretically, I don't like to use the word should, but if there's somebody who should deserve something like this, or who deserves, you deserve this. Well, I don't know. I mean, do we deserve things in our lives? There are people who work their asses off in this world without any desire for reward, really. They just do it, right? They get up and they put on whatever they need to put on and they do it. Do they deserve something? I think they do. You ask them if they deserve anything, they probably say no. Deserving is an aspect of entitled. Entitlement and deserving are kind of cousins, if you ask me. But anyway, I think if anyone, in quotes, air quotes, deserves to have success in her realm, it's Regina. And she's worked long and hard at Gaia for quite a long time now. And she's really connected with a lot of people who she's going to take with her in her new venture. And it's going to be Gaia's loss. I'm telling you right now. Anyway, that hopefully should be up in a week or two. People have been asking about it. So anything else on the astrology tip that we need to talk about from my world? The one thing, pretty soon here after Thanksgiving, I'm going to start to post some Christmas specials on my website. And these are always fun. And what I do is I offer up half hour readings, and I make it really affordable. So if you wanted to gift people with a half hour reading, if you wanted to gift multiple people these are great Christmas gifts, by the way, holiday gifts. People go, wow, you got me an astrological reading? Wow, isn't that cool? So there'll be tiers. There'll be hour readings, but there'll be packages. You can get like two or three readings. They're either going to be 30-minute readings or hour readings, and they'll be priced accordingly. They'll be discounted because you're obviously getting more readings. And also, I will be discounting my course for a brief period of time during the holidays. So if you have somebody who is really into astrology, and you know that they're into astrology, I'm going to make my course available. But that's not going to be probably until maybe the first week of December. And it'll only be for a week. So you'll have a week to get a discount on my course. But other than that, I think that's quite a bit, actually. So keep your eye out for those specials. I do it every year. And they're very, very popular. The only caveat is I don't start to do the readings for the holiday specials until after the third week in January. And it's because I have to kind of space out the holidays and stuff like that. And then I approach it accordingly. But people like it. It's a really, and you know, I also provide a visual, you know, like a little card that you can actually print out, a certificate that all comes with it. So if you're looking for a unique way to gift your friends and family, certainly this qualifies. Okay, that's about it for today. I got to get out of here. I got to go do one of my everything readings. So, hey, hang in there. Keep the vibe high. Keep it up. You know, we're going to get through this. I'm telling you, we're going to get through this. And then we get to deal with AI. Oh, boy. Oh, yeah. You know, the thing about AI, before I go, here's the thing about AI. This is what I'm going to say. This is a challenge to you and I. This is a challenge for us to accelerate our spiritual process, to keep up with AI, okay? This is the challenge. What is the model that competes with AI? It is full-blown spiritual awareness to the point where we are operating at a completely different level than we are right now. Right? Think of the organic version of AI and what we could do when those pesky little DNA strands are entangled. That's where we need to go. And maybe we could focus maybe one day a week on how to get there through diet, through sound, through whatever it is. It's time. Because we're going to have to take on this competing system. All right. That's it. So, well, it wasn't quite 30 minutes. We got 22:50, but it's a little more than 15. A little more than 15. Use your head to discern what's real, your heart to see what's possible. I'm Robert Phoenix. You've been listening to 15 Minutes of Flame. I'll be back tomorrow morning, same time, same channel, here on Spreaker.com and YouTube.